last week. It's written about John 3:16. What a privilege it is, guys, that we get to worship our Savior, Jesus Christ, who, one of the coolest verses in the Bible, Paul said, all the promises of God find their yes in Jesus Christ. All the promises of God find their yes in Jesus Christ. And he always keeps his promises. He is faithful and he is just in this life and for all eternity. He's got you. All right. Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, mind what you're looking. We're going to sing a little bit of the hymn, Standing on the Promises. But the next song, I have to apologize ahead of time. It's called Glorious Day. And I thought it was the glorious day that you guys knew. The one that you guys have sung quite a bit. I'm trying not to overload you with too many new songs. So I get here and I ask Nathaniel, and he goes, they've never sung that glorious day. So I apologize, throwing too many new songs at you at once. I did not mean to. You guys forgive me? Okay. All right. Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages, let us praise him. glory in the highest, I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. And standing on the promises, I, Christ my Lord, bound to him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God. Till I met you. You know two Glorious Day songs. One of the things that Paul said was, if in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are the most to be pitied. But in fact, he said, Christ has been raised from the dead. Amen? He has been raised, and he has raised us. And we will meet the Lord in the air. Oh, thank you. We will meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord because he keeps his promises. He is faithful and just. I'm sorry, but this is another new one. Like I said, I thought I was throwing in one you knew, so this is a real learning curve this morning. But you know, we all are at different ages. We've got little kids in here all the way to people who are probably pushing 100. We've got an entire century represented in here, right? And all of us can say the best is yet to come. It is only unbelievers who can say, oh, those were the good old days, or those were the golden days. Nothing will be as good as back then. Not us. Is that true? The best is yet to come. Not just talking about heaven, but even today, tomorrow, we have a Savior who is conforming us to his image, who promises, he promises that he is working in us and will be faithful to work in us and conform us until the day he takes us home. And then the best is yet to come again. I believe that the future is brighter, and I believe in his promise for me. I believe that he's working.
Shining as
right. You can have a seat.
Welcome, 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 everybody. It's great to be here. At this time, the kids can be dismissed. Sandy and Jessica are going to be at the back. They're going to head out, go have some fun, learn something. It's great to be here again. I missed you guys last week. So great to see you. And for those joining online, too, thanks for joining us and being a part. Here's some announcements coming up. There's a flyer in the bulletin. You can find everything in your bulletin. That's really good. September 11th, one of our missionaries that you heard last week, Harry Olson, and his wife Carol, on 9 a.m., will be presenting their ministry and what they do. I've seen a lot of what he does also. And so if you could, if you want to come and learn about the ministry, he's an awesome resource, actually, for this church, too. Recently wrote a really good book about sharing your faith. But come and enjoy that. I would recommend it. And you can sign up to bring some goodies to share with that breakfast. Yeah, 9 a.m., that's breakfast. Also, this week, Thursday, a couple of things happening. You've got prayer for revival in the war room. And then there's a special presentation of Living History Days at 7 o'clock p.m. this Thursday. Let me open us with a word of prayer. Father God, you are worthy of our praise, God. Your love, your graciousness, God, your generosity, Father, surpasses everything that we can even imagine, even that we ask for. Father, you are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our heart's devotion, God, and it's just a privilege, Father, to be a part of your church, to be your children. God, we just pray that you would work in this service. Pray that you would work in our hearts, Father, that your will would be done. Father, we come to you, God, in need as a church, as a body, in need of a pastor and leadership and direction. Father, we just pray that your will would be done and that you would bring a godly man, wise man that can lead and that can direct. Father, we just pray that you would open our hearts, Father, to your word, that you would give the message that we need to hear that would encourage us and guide us on our way. We pray, God, that you would use us to be your witnesses, Lord, that we would be mindful of opportunities to share what you have done in our lives, just the good things that you have done in our lives, because you are real. And we ask this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Becca also wants to share a word about something coming up.
Last week it was mentioned that there is my dad, Harry, talked about a Bible school that is for people who are older, who are, you know, maybe are past thinking about going to Bible school, you know, with the 19-year-olds. Like Nathaniel, maybe you are interested in going further and knowing stuff. This is a 2-year commitment, but you meet once a week, and probably either on Zoom, or if there's a group of women here who want to meet, or men, I'm going to be leading a women's group. So please come right after the service, as soon as we say amen, come on up, and I'll just find out if there's an interest. I've had a couple of ladies bring it up to me. So we would just meet once a week. You know, like on a Monday night or a Tuesday night or something like that. We would just meet for a little bit, and you'd watch videos during the week. If there are men who are interested in this training as well, Bible training, you can come to me, and I'll give you the website so that you can hook up with another one or start your own. Either way, I can give you info. I just wanted to get it out there, so come up afterwards if you're interested in starting a Bible school, because we have to start it right after Labor Day if we want to keep kind of on track with, you know, the rest of them. So just putting that out there. Okay.
Okay, one other announcement, just a reminder to sign up for bringing treats. There's a sign-up sheet on the table in front of the office for Sunday mornings when we have food for that. Keep that happening. Last, I get to introduce our speaker this morning, who's going to be here this week and next week. His name is Lance Thompson, and he is a member of Highland Baptist Church in Westminster. And he's been serving God all of his life. From the sound of it, he's been involved many years in youth ministry. He's currently teaching multiple adult classes during the week. He has served as a trustee and an elder and loves to share God's word. So he's going to do that this morning. His name is Lance Thompson, and please welcome him.
Good morning. I am honored to be asked to share the word with you. I love to share the word anytime I get a chance and as many opportunities as I can. When I look out over the congregation, I'm a little bit surprised because when I walked in, you were all close together and having nice fellowship there in the foyer and that. And then I look out over here and I think, you guys don't even like each other. I mean, you're just spread out all over the place. I like to see closeness and sharing together. So I enjoy sitting through a worship service with somebody, not on my own. My initial contact with this church was when I went to college. I met a young lady that was a member of this church. And I recruited her to help me in my youth ministry. And then a little later, I recruited her to become my wife. And Karen has been my wife for over 52 years now. And her mother has been an outstanding, dedicated member of this church for nearly 55 years, Melba Goodrich. So Melba is my mother-in-law, and I'm proud to have her as my mother-in-law. So let's begin with a word of prayer. Father God, you hold out so much hope for us in your word, and we have so much to look forward to when we get to heaven. And as we look at these verses and consider them this morning, I ask that your Holy Spirit would make them ring true in our hearts, that we would become even more eager to see you in heaven when we get there. So bless the preaching of your word this morning. To each heart here, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If I asked you to define God, what would you say? I would think that most of us would begin with declaring his attributes, his character, and then maybe what he has done in the past. God has many attributes. And theologians have divided them into two classes, one way to do it. One is his non-communicable attributes, things that only God can be, because he is God. These things include the omnis, you know, his omniscience, his omnipresence, his omnipotence, and his eternality as well. That means he has no beginning and no end, and he is outside of our time-space continuum. Those are things that only God can possess and no created being can be. But he has many communicable attributes too. That means things that we also have he shares with us. Some of these communicable attributes are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We read of those in Galatians 5 called the fruit of the Spirit. And God wants his children to take on his character. He wants us to grow in all those areas of his communicable attributes. But today I'd like us to focus on one particular attribute, his justice. What comes to your mind when you think of God's justice? The first thought I have is that God must punish sinners for their sin. Every sin will be punished. Ezekiel 18:20 says, the soul that sins shall die. And Romans 3:23, you know, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. Now, it strikes me quite strange that some people here on earth want to have justice, and they expect evildoers to be punished. We want murderers and thieves and rapists to put behind bars, removed from society. Yet when they get to heaven, they expect that, well, God will overlook their sin and they can still get into heaven. No, our God has even greater and higher standard of justice than we do. And it demands that he punish evildoers. the justice, according to our thinking, expects a greater punishment for a greater offense, right? And I believe that's true for God's justice as well. Revelation 20, 11 and 12 says, I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. And books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books, according to what they had done. Then in Luke chapter 10, Jesus, he was sending his disciples out throughout Judea and Galilee to proclaim that the kingdom of God is near. And he told his disciples when he sent them out, whenever you enter a town and they do not receive you, it will be more tolerable on that day for Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago. It will be more bearable in the judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. And then again in Luke 12, 47 and 48. That servant who knew his master's will, but did not get ready or act according to his will receive a severe beating. But the one who did not know and did what deserved a beating will receive a light beating. You know, these indicate to me that there are levels of punishment in hell. But on the other hand, with all sinners being cast into the lake of fire for eternal torment, what's the degree of difference there? Doesn't seem too significant to me. They all suffer that same fate. Now, we've seen all sin must be punished. Will our sins? Some Christians have the idea that when some serious illness befall them and they're going through suffering or a great tragedy in their life, that God is punishing them for their sin. Have you ever had that thought? Beloved, that can't be. Impossible. For those who have accepted Christ's death on the cross on their behalf and seek to live according to his commands, praise God, your sins are already judged and they are fully paid for on the cross of Christ. Galatians 1:4, Jesus Christ gave himself for our sins. 1 Corinthians 15:3, Christ died for our sins. In 1 John 2:12, your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. Now, if your sins are already forgiven, God is not going to blame you for them again. They are gone. And so, Paul wrote in Romans 8:1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. God has already punished all our sins, past, present, and future, at the cross. And I love this verse, 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, that so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's the best transaction you'll ever make in your life. The best business deal you can do. I give him my sin, he gives me his righteousness. I have no more sin. When God sees me, I am righteous. So, beloved, if you're undergoing trials, some suffering, some tragedy, and the thought enters your mind that it's because of some sin you've committed, say this: get thee behind me, Satan. All my sins are paid for by Jesus at the cross. We've seen that God's justice demands that he punish sin. But here's my main thought for today and next week also. There's another side to God's justice. He not only punishes sin, but he rewards our good service. I would like everybody to turn with me to Hebrews chapter 6 in your Bible. This is a key verse, and it gives me so much comfort. Hebrews chapter 6. Verse 10 talks about God's justice. He says in Hebrews 6:10, for God is not unjust so as to overlook your work and the love that you have shown for his name in serving the saints as you still do. See, his justice demands that he reward his children for their service. The Bible tells us a lot about our rewards that God will judge us and reward the righteous. A couple of these verses out of many, Psalm 62:12, for you will render to a man according to his work, punishment for evil, but reward for our righteous works. Matthew 16:27, the Son of Man will repay each person according to what he has done. That's good or bad. Matthew 5:12, great is your reward in heaven. In Matthew 6:20, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. You can expect rewards when we get to heaven for our service. So you see, there's two great issues that we decide when we're here on this earth. The first one, where will we spend eternity? If you have placed your faith and trust in Christ for his sacrifice as payment for your sins and believe that he is going to save you and take you to heaven, then you will go to heaven with him, where we will spend eternity. The second great decision you make while you're on this earth is what will eternity be like for you? Because we can accumulate treasure in heaven. We can store up treasure and get rewards. Certainly the main reward, the greatest reward, is eternal life, living with God forever. Jesus alludes to this reward in a parable in Matthew 20, where he likens the kingdom of heaven to the master of a house who hires workers for his vineyard at 6 o'clock. I'm sure you remember this parable. And sends them to his vineyard. He goes back into town at 9 o'clock and sees some men standing around and says, well, go work in my vineyard. I'll pay you what's fair. He goes back into town at 12 o'clock. I don't know why he keeps going into town, but he sees some more men standing around. Go work in my vineyard, I'll pay you what's fair. Goes back into town at 3 o'clock and sees some men standing around. What are you doing standing around here all day? Well, no one's hired us. Go into my vineyard, I will pay you what's fair. And after that, even at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, he sees some other men and sends them to his vineyard. I'll pay you what's fair. And you know how the story goes. At the end of the day, maybe 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock, it's time to pay the men their daily wages. And he pays them all the same amount. They each get a full day's pay. Now, there's a lot of lessons in this parable, but the one that I want to focus on or point out is that no matter how long you've served Jesus, then we all get the same reward. We all get to have eternal life with God in heaven. Whether you've served Jesus for 70 years faithfully, like the Apostle John did, or whether you've believed in Jesus only for 1 hour, like the thief on the cross, all receive that same gift of eternal life. But there are rewards that differ. Turn with me to the left a little bit to 2 Corinthians. Find 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. 2 Corinthians 5:10 reads, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. So this verse tells us who will be at the judgment seat of Christ, and it tells us why they will be there. Notice Paul, he's writing to the believers in the church of Corinth, includes himself at this judgment. For we must all appear. As he's talking to all believers, that the judgment seat of Christ, only believers are present. Those who refuse to accept Christ's sacrifice for them and try to get to heaven on their own merit, on their own standards, they won't be here, but they're going to be judged at the great white throne judgment that I read about in Revelation 20. The Greek word for this place of judgment, the judgment seat of Christ, is the Bema seat. And at the Bema, it was a stand that at the end of an athletic competition, they would reward, hand out a wreath, some kind of a crown for their achievement. It is not a place of punishment for failures. It is only they hand out rewards for accomplishment. So we are there not to determine our salvation, but to receive reward for what we have done, our service. Now, some might think that the ending of this verse, it says, whether good or evil, means that their sins are now exposed for judgment. But this can't be, as we've already seen, that our sins are already judged and they're fully paid for at the cross. He is not weighing our good works against our sin. We have no sin. Now let's read Paul's description of what happens at the Bema seat, the judgment seat of Christ. Turn to the left again a little more to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And 1 Corinthians 3, verse 11. We will start there. And this is, I think, a description of what takes place at the judgment judgment seat of Christ for believers. 1 Corinthians 3, 11 to 15. I've got it here somewhere. There it is. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Now, if anyone builds on that foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. So picture this is what goes on. At the Bema seat of Christ, Jesus is going to say, Lance, step forward. He steps forward, and all that I've done since I've been saved will pass through the fire for the judgment of fire. And whatever service I've done for Christ, for his church, out of love for God and love for his body, the fellow believers, with pure motives, will pass through the fire, and it's going to come out like gleaming gold, shiny silver, or sparkling gems, and I will receive rewards. But those things, those acts of service that I do, whether I'm teaching a Bible study, or leading a Sunday school class, or doing good deeds for people, if it was done for impure motives, whether I've done it just to be seen of men, to vaunt, build up myself, my pride, or I do it for greed, impure motives, those are just going to be burned up and will be gone. And none of those will survive. And even if all my works fall into that category, he says here that if all my deeds after I was saved were burned up, I will still be saved. Just I'll pass through the fire. So we will have our service and deeds judged through the fire at the judgment seat of Christ. Bruce Wilkinson has said, our eternal destination is the consequence of what we believe on earth. Our eternal compensation is the consequence of how we behave on earth. Now, I'll tell you a little secret. I believe that every believer is going to receive some reward when we get to heaven. Jesus said in Mark 9:41, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink just because you belong to Christ will by no means lose his reward. So I think everyone's going to receive some reward. When does this Bema, the judgment seat of Christ, take place? Well, there's differing opinions on this. Jesus told a parable called the 10 minas in Luke 19:11 to 27. And let's turn to Luke 19 and let's read that one together. Luke 19, starting at verse 11. Jesus tells this parable when he and his disciples are with a mass of pilgrims heading to Jerusalem. They're coming up from the valley where the Jordan River is. They've already gone through Jericho, and Jesus has healed a blind man. And now they are approaching Jerusalem at the time of Passover, for the annual feast of Passover. And in just a day, two or three days, Jesus will ride into Jerusalem on what we call Palm Sunday, and he will be proclaimed to be the King of Israel, the legal descendant to the throne from David, by the throngs on Palm Sunday. So as they're approaching Jerusalem, Jesus tells them this parable in Luke 19, verse 11. As they heard these things, he proceeded to tell a parable because he was near to Jerusalem, and because they supposed that the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. He said, therefore, a nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then return. Calling 10 of his servants, he gave them 10 minas, and he gave each servant one mina, and said to them, engage in business until I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him, saying, we do not want this man to reign over us. When he returned, having received his kingdom, he ordered those servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know what they had gained by doing business. The first came before him, saying, Lord, your mina has made 10 minas more. He said to him, well done, good servant, because you have been faithful in a very little, you shall have authority over 10 cities. And the second came, saying, Lord, your mina has made 5 minas. And he said to him, and you are to be over 5 cities. Then another came, saying, Lord, here is your mina, which I kept laid away in a handkerchief. For I was afraid of you, because you are a severe man. You take what you did not deposit, and reap what you did not sow. He said to him, I will condemn you with your own words, you wicked servant. You knew that I was a severe man, taking what I did not deposit, and reaping what I did not sow. Why then did you not put my money in the bank, and at my coming I might have collected it with interest? And he said to those who stood by, take the mina from him and give it to the one who has the 10 minas. They said to him, Lord, he has 10 minas. I tell you that to everyone who has, more will be given, but from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. But as for these enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them before me. There's a lot of truth we can glean out of this parable, but I just want to focus on a couple of things. The nobleman goes to a faraway country to receive for himself a kingdom. And he leaves one mina with each of 10 of his servants to invest while he's gone. Now we know that in maybe 47 days, 48 days from the telling of this parable, Jesus does ascend to his Father to receive his reward, his kingdom. He's the nobleman that goes away. And after receiving the kingdom, he will return and call his servants to himself to see what they had done, and will reward them for their faithfulness. Now, just before Jesus left this earth, he said to his disciples, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. Beloved, that's the mina he has left with me. That's the mina he's left with you. Are we investing those minas in the Lord's kingdom, or are we hiding them away? A similar parable says in Matthew 25:31, when the Son of Man returns in his glory and with all his angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. I think this throne is the judgment seat of Christ. When will it occur? Well, is it when we die and go to heaven and be with Jesus? Maybe. That's possible. When we die and our soul goes to heaven, that he will try our works in that and reward us for our faithfulness. Then again, the text says that when he returns for us. Now, if your view of eschatology is premillennial or pre-trib, you will think that is be at the rapture, when Christ comes on the clouds for his church and takes us to be with him in heaven. If your perspective is amillennial or pre or post-tribulation, that'll be when Christ returns to earth to set up his earthly kingdom. Now, both of these are Bible interpretations, and there's scriptural support for both perspectives of the end times. But you know, there's nothing profitable about arguing over them. Paul wrote to his young protege, Timothy, in 2 Timothy 2:14, charge the elect before God not to quarrel about words, which does no good, but only ruins the hearers. And in 1 Timothy 6:4, he says that the craving for controversy and for quarrels about words only produces envy, dissension, and constant friction among people. So, beloved, let's not argue about things that God has not made clear in the Scripture. We don't know for sure which view is correct. Maybe neither one is perfectly correct. But in the end, all will be revealed. What will our rewards be? You know, the New Testament names five crowns that we can earn. And they're listed, they're given in the New Testament. So next week, I'm going to take a look at all five crowns that we can earn and what they'll be given out for. What will your reward be? For now, I'll leave you with these thoughts. Revelation 3:11. I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have so that no one may seize your crown. In 2 John verse 8, watch yourselves so that you may not lose what we have worked for, but may win a full reward. Father, I thank you that you punish evildoers, but you also promised that you will reward those who have committed their lives to you and serve you faithfully. And Lord, as we look to next week to these five crowns that we might earn, I pray that we will be touched by your Spirit to work for those crowns and see what the Word has to say for them. And Lord, just encourage each one here this morning, knowing that we will receive rewards for the faithful years that we serve you. I pray this in Jesus' name.
He was speaking of heaven. I thought it would be good to end with songs pointing us to those thoughts about what the future is going to look like. One thing we do know is it does say that we may throw our crowns at the feet of Jesus. Let's stand together and sing. We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus, the greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus, and we cry, holy, 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 we cry, holy, 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 we cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. we just stand in awe of you. You don't just hang on to us while we have breath. You didn't just die to save us in the moment, but you took our sin for all time and then beyond time. And then you keep rewarding us even past this life. Oh Lord, we don't deserve it. We do not deserve it. But our lives are hidden in Christ, your Son. And we are grateful. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you have done. Amen. All right, you are dismissed. Those who want to talk about the classes can come up and chat with me if you want. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Hey, everybody, could you sit down for just a second? I have a couple things I want to go over. Sorry, Rebecca. I tried to get him out of here. Lance.